But what makes it so special is that it's also the oldest race. The first one was back in 1961, when things were a little more leisurely. The man who started it all was Sir Max Aitken, who owned the Daily Express, fell in love with power boating on a trip to the United States, and bought himself this boat, Glass Moppy. In that first race, it was adventure enough simply to take part. And when they got to Torquay after a long haul, well, they called it a day and headed for the Imperial Hotel.
Well, it's a bit like point to point as against the classic Ascot, you know. The average speed, I think, of the first race was run at about 28 knots or 30 knots, something like that.
Really? What was the atmosphere like, though, in 1961?
I think that just as much champagne was being drunk. It was enthusiastic amateurs, and the Hairy Boys used to bring their outboard boats, come down from Middlesex and the London area and bring them down. They're very enthusiastic, but of course, you see, they hadn't been on waters like these before, and there used to be a lot of pranks and bash-ups because if they hit a two-foot wave out here, it sorted some of them out in those days.
I gather Lord Lucan used to race.
Lord Lucan, yes. We've got a photograph of Lord Lucan pirouetting up in the sky in his powerboat. Who else? Tommy Southfield, of course, he won the first one. As I say, it's an average speed of 28 knots, I think.
Today, things aren't quite the same. Among those enthusiastic amateurs of 1961 was Don Shedd, now one of the world's top designers.
I've changed the deep V boats we've been designing over the last 15 years, I mean, comparatively little. The boats which we run now, like the one behind me, which is the very latest one from CUV in Italy, bears very great resemblance to the You Know What, and which I used to race here, and You Know Embassy, and all those boats. So the changes are very slight. The real difference is in not just engines and also propulsion systems. There's a lot more power around, a colossal amount more power.
The greater the power, of course, the greater the risk. And just 7 days earlier in the Solent, this boat was traveling at around 85 to 90 when it hit the wake of an oil tanker and flipped over. The three French crew members were killed, including Didier Peroni, the one-time motor racing ace. The tragedy begged questions about design, about whether safety belts should be worn, as Peroni had been wearing, about helmets, some of which increase the risk of a broken neck, some the risk of drowning. So, should there be changes?
No, I don't think there are going to be any changes in crash helmet design. Crash helmets were designed to actually be knocked around a boat. If you hit the dashboard, you hit the side of the boat. If you look at this boat, there's a steering wheel. If you hit the steering wheel, that's what crash helmets were designed for. They weren't designed to be turned upside down and hit the water at 80 miles an hour. As far as boat design is concerned, no, I think the boat designs are intrinsically very safe.
But what about the speeds at which the boat go? I mean, the engines are getting bigger and faster all the time, aren't they?
That's a question I think that all of us as safety have uppermost in our mind at the moment. Yes, the boats are going faster. And expressing a personal view, I think there is going to come a time when we're going to have to start looking at limiting the speed of Class 1 offshore powerboats in no different way to the way they're limiting speed of Formula 1 racing motor cars.
In the shadow of the Peroni accident, caution is the key word this weekend, and on the race course tomorrow, competitors will be outnumbered by safety boats 2-1. This morning, the scrutineers are carrying out 50 safety checks on every one of the entries.
And if Nigel could please...
Nigel, could you give her a quick
turn the wheel?
Flares, radios, life jackets, even steering mechanism.
Is that little bit of movement?
Here.
Is that something you've done about?
Yes.
Right, okay,
yes.
I can see that.
And I'll come back later to make sure that is then okay.
Meantime, some of the fans are scrutinizing the scrutineers, while others make their way to the tents on the quayside and a lunch of beef burgers and beer, unless they happen to be members of the elite. Here in a marquee erected on a helicopter pad over the Solent, specially invited competitors and guests enjoy haute cuisine and fine wine and being where the action is.